So with that, I want to introduce Rick Wolff. Enjoy the talk.
Thank you all for coming. Can you all hear what I'm saying? Good. I want to thank the Carpenters Union for making this space available to us. It makes me feel very, very good to see a cooperation between a community radio station and a trade union. That's something that once existed in the United States, alliances between labor unions and many other community groups, because they recognized that each of them would be stronger through the alliance with the other one. And if we're relearning that lesson now, it's very good for us. And I could not be happier if I can help develop that kind of solidarity once again. All right, my job is to talk to you a little bit about the economic situation we face, why it is the way it is, where it's going, and what it means to you. But before I jump into that, two things. First, a request. Some of the things I'm about to explain to you are going to get you upset. I want you to remember that I'm just the messenger. I didn't cause the things I'm going to describe to you. And so I'm urging you to remember that it is not appropriate to shoot the messenger just because you don't like the message. Okay. The second thing is actually to begin by telling you what I did last night. Last night I spoke at a place called Truman State University, about 3 hours north of here in Kirksville, small town in a county that went overwhelmingly for Mr. Trump. They have a speaker series. They invited me to come there. The auditorium they selected holds about 240 people. And 250 came. There were no seats left, the people were standing around. About 250, 255 folks came. The overwhelming majority of them, I would say, were between 18 and 25 years of age. And they were there because they are upset about what is happening in their lives and those of their families. They can't afford the cost of the school, they can't handle the debts. They're frightened about the jobs, they're frightened about the incomes, they're frightened about a lot. Most of them had never heard of me. They weren't there because of me or my performance skills, which I will try to demonstrate to you in a few minutes. They came because they are upset, and the mood in the auditorium was electric. I had what I'm having more and more of, and that I want to tell you about before I jump into tonight's. I had an evening that left me with more, not less, energy than I began with. Meetings like that are energizing. You come away with reserves of energy you didn't know you had because the mood was so good. These are young people who are determined to change the country, who are not trying simply to solve their problem by finding their own personal escape way. I'll take this course, I'll major in that subject, I'll transfer to over here. No. They understood that it's kind of too late for that. That to save their situation, they're gonna have to change the society and the way it works. 250 people in Kirksville, Missouri felt that way. You multiply that by all the other Kirksvilles in this country, and we win. We will win. And that's already a reality. I make about 2 trips a month. I can't do more, I'm too busy, too many other things to do. Last month I made a trip to California, where I go often. I spoke in the First Presbyterian Church of Berkeley, California. It's like one of those mega churches. It holds about 700 people in a huge auditorium. And they are a fundraiser for a local public radio station called KPFA. It's a Pacifica station. Every seat was taken in that place. They sold tickets for $20 a person. And it was like a pep rally. thought about halfway through, I'd stop explaining things and I'd just get out pom-poms and jump up and down. Because people were so determined to do something, it was, again, electric. 4 days later, I went north of San Francisco to a place called Rohnert Park. Some of you may have heard of it. It is the home of a place called the Sonoma State University, part of the California state system. There I was, the resident scholar, at the invitation of the president of the university with whom I had dinner before my talk. When I discussed with them before I came what they would like me to speak to the public university-sponsored talk I gave in the evening, this is last month, the president of the university said to me, "We would like you to present a criticism of capitalism." You can't make this up. I didn't suggest it, they did. So when I came to their campus and did precisely that, I didn't have to worry for 1 second because I was doing what they asked me to do. America is changing in fast and fundamental ways. You may read about the Tea Party and Trump and all of the rest because they get the publicity, they're well connected to get it. But stuff is happening at the other end of the spectrum as fast and as profound as anything happening on the right. You will not hear about it unless people like me who are caught up in it tell you about it, which is why I am doing that now. My last talk on the trip to California was at a place called Berkeley City College, a working class institution that people go to when they have a moment out of their job or at the end of the day to get accredited in credits and so on. The kind of places I really like to go and speak. And that auditorium had about 200 people in it. Again, mostly students, but some faculty and some community people. A few months ago, I was the scholar in residence at the University of Kentucky in Lexington. Same story. A few months before that, I did a fundraiser for WMNF. It is a very powerful public radio system that serves Tampa, St. Petersburg, and Sarasota, Clearwater, Florida. It is the biggest audience for my radio show, which is now broadcast every week on 75 stations across the United States. Why am I telling you this? Because something is changing in the United States, big time. And I want you to know it so that you don't feel as isolated, as surrounded by people who don't agree with you, as you already do. That is the reasonable result of the last 50 years of this country, where you were made to feel weird, strange, isolated, odd for having the views you do. And it was right for us to say we can't do very much in a society that demonizes us in this way. But that is not the case anymore. If we don't act now, we will have missed a window of opportunity for folks like us that hasn't been here for half a century, and I don't know how long it will last. But if we don't act now, it's on us, because we can. I am a critic of capitalism. I don't like it, I don't think it works real well, and I think the human race can do a lot better. Is that clear? Good. And wherever I go and I explain that, I get warm, enthusiastic receptions, just like I did from the 255 people in Kirksville, Missouri last night. You are not alone, you are not isolated, you are not small. And if you feel that way, you're doing the work of the people who want us not to succeed. Don't let them color your perception. And for those of you that are older like me, remember, it wasn't this way before the post-World War II period, and therefore it doesn't have to continue, and it is in fact disappearing. Occupy Wall Street was a major step in getting us to this. Bernie Sanders' campaign was a major step in getting us to this. The story I just told you about what's happening to me is another little step in this process. You can be making the difference in the things you do. So as a person who's one of you, I'm pleading with you, get going, do things, get together, make organizations, figure out your own ways to move this country forward. It's possible now. It would be a shame for us and our children not to do it. And it's possible now. Okay, let me turn then to the economics of the situation we are in. I meet on a regular basis with pretty famous economists because I went to the right schools, and for those of you who haven't figured this out yet, let me remind you. In our country, it is not what you know, it is who you know. And if you haven't figured that out yet, you will. I promise. So because I went to Harvard, Stanford, and Yale, I know all the right people. My classmate at Yale when I got my PhD degree was a woman, and there were very few women in those days. The woman sitting on my left was a woman named Janet Yellen, who's the head of the Federal Reserve. Right? You become part of an old boy network if you go to these kinds of schools, and so I am. And I meet with some of my friends in New York City who are hedge fund managers or bankers or whatever. And we don't agree how the country got into this mess, and we don't agree how the country should get out. But we actually discovered over the last couple of years that we do agree on something, which we were all surprised about. Here's what we agree on. The United States economy is in the worst condition that we have ever seen any of us in our lifetimes. That's the assessment right now. And these include very conservative, very left-wing, and all shades in between of perceptions. So when you hear that we are engaged in an economy that is recovering, you are listening to the wrong program. You are listening to the kind of program which, if I upset you today, you should return to in the evening TV news and you will no longer be bothered. In a world of recovery, and it's all a mirage, there is nothing like that. Capitalism, global capitalism, collapsed in the last 4 months of 2008. In those months, there were hysterical meetings in New York City among bankers, Federal Reserve officials, and a whole host of others, desperate to try to figure out how to stop the disintegration of the American economy, which was understood to mean not just the banks fall apart, which they did, not just the insurance industry dissolve, which it did, but that the regular day-to-day life would stop. The milk wouldn't be delivered, the eggs wouldn't be delivered, the buses wouldn't run, the trains would stop, that kind of a breakdown. We were that close. That kind of a collapse was never supposed to happen. We were supposed to have learned from the great crash of the 1930s how to make sure that didn't happen again. We had learned monetary policy and fiscal policy and what the Federal Reserve should do and what the government should do in deficit spending, and all of these wonderful tools which would not give us this crash again. Every president, starting with Franklin Roosevelt, made the same promise. If you do what I propose to be done, not only will I get you out of the current economic downturn, but I will make sure by these policies that we never have such a downturn again. Every president promised it. No president ever delivered it. The promise was false. And the proof of it was the collapse of 2008. But for those of you that like statistics, between the end of the Great Depression in 1941 and the beginning of the crash of 2008, we had 11 more economic downturns. Capitalism has a downturn every 4 to 7 years, wherever it exists, and it always has. For those of you who've heard the following joke, bear with me. If you lived with a roommate as unstable as capitalism, you would have moved out long ago. And you should wonder why you stay with an economic system that works like this. Every 4 to 7 years, millions lose their jobs. People lose their homes. Careers are interrupted. School educational processes are interrupted. Debts are increased. Why do we do this to ourselves? Why do we permit such an economic system that is so fundamentally unstable? And you know, capitalists have tried to fix that. They've tried to come up with plans and procedures. That's why every president promised it, to prevent it, to stop it, to limit it. There's a whole school of economics that's taught in places like, UMKC. It's called Keynesian economics, after Lord John Keynes in England, who developed this theory in the 1930s of how the government could and should intervene to make sure we don't have crises. Very sophisticated, good professors, they teach it all. It just doesn't work, which is why we had a crash in 2008. We can't control this system's instability, which you would think in a rational population ought to make people say, if there's a system that has an awful quality that hurts us and we don't want, maybe we should think about, get ready, another system. Maybe we should change it. Maybe. So it crashed in 2008. And what was the thing that was done? It's amazing if you go over it. The banks and big businesses, who had made a regular, enjoyable activity of explaining to the American people, you and me, how private enterprise is the engine of progress, and how the government is a fat, overloaded, inefficient, private is good and public. What happened in the autumn of 2008? All those people sang a new song. They all rushed to Washington begging the government that they had denounced to save them from extinction. Let's go over. Every single major money center bank, Bank of America, Wells Fargo, were bankrupt. They could not function. They could not function. The largest automobile company in this country could not function, General Motors. The largest insurance company in the United States and indeed in the world, AIG Corporation, could not function. The government bailed them all out, saved them from collapse. Oh yes, they thought for a while they wouldn't have to. So they let one of them die, called Lehman Brothers. They let it go. And the effect of that was so terrifying that they bailed every other one out right afterwards. They took a lot of, your money to bail them out. So on behalf of all these banks and big companies, I want to be the first to say to all of you, thank you. Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for bailing us out after we've explained that you, the public, the government, are inefficient crumble bums who we barely tolerate. We private, efficient enterprises. They weren't private. I take that back. They were private. They weren't efficient. They weren't successful. They were disasters. We bailed them out. Federal Reserve loaned these banks trillions. The U.S. Treasury bought shares of stock, special kinds of shares of stock in the banks, wonderful shares of stock. They're called non-voting stock. Here's how it works. The bank gives you a very low-value piece of paper, and the Treasury buys the piece of paper, it's a share of stock, for $50 a share. It's non-voting stock. So the government gets to give money to the bank for the share, but the government has no vote over what the bank does. Hey, this is a wonderful idea. You ought to try that sometime. You'll get arrested. But if you're a big bank, you get an award. Depends on who you are. We bailed them out. We bailed out the AIG Corporation. The government simply took it over at the hefty cost of $80 billion. General Motors, the government, took over for years. Bailed it out. You paid for all of that. What did you get? Remarkable. You did save the banks. So again, on their behalf, let me thank you. And you saved General Motors. It continues to make the same mediocre cars it did before. And the AIG Corporation limps along, a shadow of its former self, but it's still alive. Here's the people who didn't get bailed out. 5 million people who lost their homes. Too bad, sorry. We couldn't find the money for you. We couldn't save your home, your family, your trauma of going through being evicted, having your stuff thrown out on the sidewalk and having everyone in the neighborhood look at you. Those people we didn't bail out. Wages. Wages in this country have stagnated. For the entire time since the crash, wages have gone nowhere. Profits have gone through the roof because bailing out the banks with your money got them going again so they could make a lot of money, which they did. And General Motors is having a great year or two. It's wonderful. Thank you again. They got bailed out. You didn't. You didn't. Millions of people lost their jobs. Out of those millions, roughly half have left the labor force. They gave up. They are not now living either off their savings, that doesn't last very long, off their friends and neighbors, that lasts longer, or doing something which the government doesn't keep track of. Let me say that again. Living off something the government doesn't keep track of. One more time. Doing illegal things that they don't want anyone to keep a record of. One of them is ravaging this country. It's called the opioid epidemic. When I went to Kentucky last spring to be the scholar in residence at that university, I talked about capitalism, and they listened very attentively. But when it was over and I said, well, what are you folks excited about? They said, heroin, it's killing us. White people's heroin is killing us. Because in these parts of the country, it's white people who for the first time are experiencing the level of epidemic that has already decimated other communities at other times. The other half of the people who were once unemployed, those who didn't leave the labor force, have come back in the labor force. That's what you hear about. The unemployment rate is down. Here's the detail. The jobs, they're terrible. They're jobs without benefits. They're jobs without security. They're jobs without any hope. The jobs lost had those things. The jobs that replaced them don't. You know what that's called? A decline in the standard of living. Which means the people who went back to work paid the price of a decline in their standard of living. Here's a little story for you. I live in Manhattan. Around the corner from me in Manhattan is a Starbucks. That doesn't make me unique because around the corner in every block in Manhattan is a Starbucks. It looks, tastes, and smells exactly like every other one. That's because Americans are deeply committed to individuality. Right? Think about it. Every Starbucks looks the same, every McDonald's looks the same, every Burger King looks the same, every Pizza Hut looks the same. Yeah? We are a country of rugged individualism. Heaven forbid someone would make something different. So I'm sitting there having my morning coffee one day, and a young woman, I guess 20 years old, maybe 21, comes in. She's shy, she's a little nervous. She goes up to the counter where a young black American, African American, is making, you know, working there making coffees. And he's very sweet to her, and he says, you know, what kind of coffee would you like? And kind of stammering, I'm sitting there, so I overhear it all. She doesn't want a coffee, she would like an application form. She'd like to get a job. And he looks at her with a kind of sweetness, and he says to her, look, do you mind my asking, do you have a bachelor's degree? Do you have a BA degree from college? And her face falls, and she says, no, I'm in college, but I dropped out because I have to make some money, which is why I want to get this job here, so I can save up some money and go back and get my college. So he says, look, I'll take your form, but I got to tell you, if you don't have a BA, there's no job for you at Starbucks. No job for her to sweep the place, no job for her to make the coffee, which, as you know, takes an advanced PhD degree to manage. Why does Starbucks do that? Because they can. because people are so desperate, are having such a hard time, but they can do that and feel good that they have hard service, leaving, of course, this young lady to slink out the door feeling bad about the situation. That's the job recovery we have experienced. The median income in the United States of a family, that means 50% of the families have more than this, 50% less. The median income of American families is lower today than it was in 2007. What recovery? What are you talking about? And it's 10 years later. For 10 years, the income of those at the top has soared, and for everybody else, nothing except opioids and Trump. Look, that's your reward. That's what you got. That's what the people got. What's going on? It's a system that works like this. That's how this system works. And the system has a name. It's called capitalism. I'm going to come back to that in a few minutes. But before I do, I want to tell you about the other big problem of capitalism, despite or besides the instability, the producing of these crashes in the 30s, now again now, with all of the stories I've just told you. I want to switch your attention for a minute to the next big virtue of capitalism. Here, ready? Here it is. It's called inequality. Inequality. Let me drive home to you, if you're not familiar with it, with a couple of statistics. I won't bore you with a lot, just a couple. Economists don't know how to talk without statistics. It's a congenital defect. Okay? The best agency in the world that keeps records of inequality all over the world is called Oxfam. Some of you have heard of it. It's a famous old British institution in England that studies and issues reports. It's been doing it for decades. Very famous. Everybody in the world uses it. So they issue a report every February on world inequality. So let's see. Here's the statistic you can take away. The 68 richest people on the planet, 68. Number one, by the way, Bill Gates. Most of these 68 are Americans. Not all, not by long shot, but most. More are Americans than any other nationality. Although you'll be surprised at how many Chinese people are entering these ranks, but for the moment, it's mostly an American phenomenon. Has names like Bill Gates and Warren Buffett and folks like that. Okay, the 68 richest people have together, if you add up the wealth each of them has into one big pile, the 68 richest people have the same, a bit more wealth than the bottom half of the population of this planet. That's 3.5 billion people. Okay, I assume in this room there are people with moral and religious commitments. They fancy themselves good Christians, good whatever. You want, someday, I need to have explained to me how you square that kind of a commitment with the number I just gave you. 68 people have more wealth than 3.5 billion. And let's remember two things. One, the 3.5 billion are the 3.5, the poor, half of the human race. Those are the people who die early of diseases they don't need to die of, who have bad housing, bad education, bad fill in the blank. They suffer. They suffer a lot because they're poor. And then there are 68 people who have more wealth than they do. Here's something to think about. If we cut the wealth of those 68 in half, they'd still be the 68 richest people in the world. But we would have half their wealth to really make a difference in the lives of 3.5 billion of our fellow human beings. You want to square that with your religion, please? Now let me drive home. What I mean, I kind of know these numbers are hard. I'm going to stay with Bill Gates. I have nothing against Bill Gates. I've never met Bill Gates. I'm sure he's very nice and pets his dog. I'm sure. If he has a dog, if not, he picks something else. Bill Gates has about $80 billion. And I thought you might be interested in what that means, in case you've never thought about it. Here's what people with that kind of money do. They hire an enterprise, or a group of them, to manage their money, because they don't know how to do it, they're not interested in doing it, and it's boring. The entity they hire in New York City usually is called a hedge fund. That's what it does. It takes the money of very wealthy institutions or people, and it invests it for them. And a typical hedge fund today in New York, if it were approached by Bill Gates, would say to him, we'll make you a clean net, after taxes and so on, 5%. They would probably offer more, but 5% is easily okay. So let's do the math. 80 billion roughly, 5% works out. I mean, these numbers are rough. I did the arithmetic exactly, so stay with me on this. That works out to, get ready, $82 million a week. That's why Bill Gates does not buy lottery tickets. He doesn't have to. He wins the lottery every week anyway, without buying any tickets. Buying tickets is for people who don't know better, like you and me, who really don't buy them to win anything. We buy them for the few hours of fantasy when we imagine what we might do if we won, which is all we're ever gonna get out of buying that ticket. He doesn't need a ticket, does he? $82 million a week. What in the world is going on? That is the fruit of the capitalist system. This is a system that produces that kind of wealth concentrated in a tiny number of people. You know where you have to go in history to get back to this kind of a level? The ancient pharaohs of Egypt. That's how much progress we've made in the intervening thousands of years. We wended our way back to that level of inequality. You know, some king embalmed in a tomb that was built by 80,000 slaves slinging bricks and stones up, and we can visit the pyramids to see what's left. What kind of an economic system is this? Why do we permit this? That's what capitalism delivers us, instability and inequality. What are we doing? Either the instability or the inequality alone should make us question this system. The two together, that's a slam dunk. We ought to be able, as a nation, to ask and answer the question, can't we do better than capitalism? We can't do better than this. Of course we can. Before I tell you how I think we're going to do it, let me tell you how some Americans you might not know about tried. So you don't think we're the first ones to come up with this idea, or the first ones to try. And if what I'm about to tell you, you are not aware of, like, for example, you might not have been aware of what Bill Gates is doing, earning $82 million a week. Of course he's a billionaire. What the hell is he going to do with all of that? How many mansions do you want to buy? 420 yachts every 15 feet? What? So he just accumulates it, and he gets more and more and more. It's like a lunatic. The system makes lunatics out of us. Well, here's an example of somebody who said something has to be done. His name is Franklin Roosevelt, President of the United States, the most popular president we ever had. He was re-elected four times. Elected four times. Re-elected three times. The only president. So frightened were the Republicans by the endless re-election of Mr. Roosevelt that they passed a law when he died to make nobody have more than two terms, which is why we have that law. No other president got anywhere close to such a record. In 1944, he's president at the time, Mr. Roosevelt sends his State of the Union message early in the year to the Congress, saying, I'd like you to pass the following legislation, which is what State of the Union messages usually do. He said, I would like to have an income tax whose top rate is 100%. Let me explain to you what this means. Every dollar that an American gets, this is a president, message to Congress, every dollar that an American gets over $25,000 a year, the government will tax them at the rate of 100%, which means every dollar over $25,000 you earn, you don't get any of it. The government gets it and uses it to help the mass of people. In today's money, it would be about $400,000 a year. That's what you can get. After that, no more. You're done. You'll just have to struggle with that. He sent this message to the Congress. I hope you'll be surprised when I tell you that the Republicans went ballistic. That's when they learned that skill. They've honed it ever since. They went ballistic, and when the dust cleared and the Democrats gave their boring speeches and Republicans repeated theirs, a compromise was reached which your president signed. The law of the United States was every dollar over $25,000 that an American gets, he keeps, ready? 6 cents. The other 94 cents went to Washington. Is this what happened in a communist country? No. Our country. Not ancient history. And if you never knew that, then that tells you something about your education. Doesn't it? Wow. There was an attempt to do something. An attempt to do something. Wow. Do you know what the income tax rate on corporations was under Roosevelt? Went up sky high. 60, 50. 70%. He taxed rich people. He taxed corporations. And guess what he did with it? He used it to create the Social Security system. We never had that before. How many of you don't know that? In the depths of the Depression, when the government had absolutely no money because millions of people were unemployed and not paying any taxes, and millions of businesses had gone out of business, they weren't paying any taxes, the government had no money, and it said, as of tomorrow, I'm going to give everybody who's 65 years of age or older a check for the rest of their life. No money, and he could do it. It's like the opposite of Kansas. With a lot of money, don't do anything. I don't mean to pick out anybody, you know, with a brown back or anything like that.
Thank you!
But in that moment, Mr. Roosevelt said, you know, he got on kind of a tear. And after he created the Social Security, he created the unemployment system. We never had that before either, folks. There was no federal unemployment insurance. He said, I am going to give every unemployed worker a check every week for years to help them through a hard time. The government that had no money. And then the best part. If the private sector either cannot or will not provide work for the millions of Americans who are out of work and want a job, well then, said Mr. Roosevelt, I will. It's my job. If the private sector, I'll do it. And between 34 and 41, he created and filled about 15 million jobs. Producing, by the way, little details like the national parks that some of you enjoy visiting. The first ecological reclamation projects of the agricultural adjustment business that was passed. Wonderful. For you that don't know it, the WPA. How many of you know a little bit about that? All over the United States, unemployed artists and sculptors and singers and people with any kind of artistic or craft skill were told, if you're unemployed, come here, the government will hire you. And put together teams of people who would then be sent all over the country to little towns and villages who had no cultural programs that they could afford. They would now be visited by a troop of professionals who had been hired by the government. It was the greatest distribution of cultural assets to the American people we've ever had. We never had anything like it before, and we have nothing like it since, unless you want to count television. Wow, what a creative thing. And how did the government pay for Social Security, unemployment compensation, and 15 million people who had a job and therefore income and therefore could make their mortgage payment and keep their house? Government had no money. You know how Roosevelt got the money? He went to the rich people and he said, you're going to give it to me. I'm going to charge you taxes up the wazoo, and you're going to give it to me. And here's why you're going to give it to me. Because if you don't, the trade union movement and the Communist Party and the Socialist Party are going to take your wealth away from you. So you better give me a part of it, because that's the price of not losing all of it. And Mr. Roosevelt said, could you say that again? And they repeated it to him. And for those of you who don't know, in the 1930s and 40s, there was a very powerful alliance of the union movement and the communists and the socialists. Big one, very successful. The unions organized something called the CIO, the Congress of Industrial Organization, the most successful union organizing drive in the history of the United States. Again, we never had anything like it before, we've never had anything like it since. And that was helped by the communists and the socialists, two socialist parties, one communist party, that worked closely with the labor unions and did all of that, including big things here in St. Louis and Kansas City, as in all American basic cities. Part of our history. And if you don't know about it, you've got a problem with how our history is taught to us, or rather not taught to us. Was Mr. Roosevelt able to tax them? Did they prevent him? Did it cost Mr. Roosevelt his career the way a politician today would say, oh, I'd love to do that, but I would never survive? He's the most successful president in American history. Let me repeat that. The president who taxed the rich to help everybody else wins the prize as the most successful president. You kind of wonder, just for a minute, why Mr. Obama didn't try that. Who knows? And at the end of the war, again for your history, at the end of the war, the right wing, the corporations, who were horrified by what they had been taxed, and the rich who were horrified by what they had been taxed, they knew they had to undo this. And at the end of the war was now over, the president died about the same time, and now it's late 1945 and 46, and the right wing says, our problem wasn't Roosevelt. He would never have done this. He's a son of a good American family with another president a while ago. He did that because he was pressured by the unions and the communists and the he was right. So they reached a strategy which the right won. Our problem isn't the Roosevelt, and it isn't the Democrats. Sorry, forgot to do this. I always forget this.
But he's reading.
We have to get rid of those people. We have to get rid of the communists and the socialists and the unions. And they went to work to do that. It began by picking the weakest link in that alliance, and that was the communists. They had to be re-described to the American people. They weren't the militants who helped build that union movement. They were agents of a foreign, scary power. The communists, the Russians, all that. And we crushed them very effectively. Then we went around, the government did this, with the help of private enemies. We went around America and we taught the American people that, you know, the socialists, they're really like the communists. They just spell it differently. But I'm serious. All my life, when I teach in the university and I begin to explain socialism and communism, I used to discover this enormously weird thing, that for my students, communist, socialist, Marxist, anarchist, it's all the same. It's just spelled differently. If you go to any European country, people understand the difference between them as like the difference between green and blue, or yellow and white, or Monday and Friday. But Americans, at first I thought Americans are stupid. Not at all. That was our history. We destroyed that. We made Americans think that if a left-wing effort is made to get you to go to a meeting or to do something, you should back away. It's gonna cost you. We are still humbled by that. That's why Americans who believe the way so many of us do, don't do anything because we're scared. We don't admit it, we don't understand it. It comes from that period of history and it has sunk real deep into the American psyche. That's our history, folks. And because we got rid of the left, we live in a capitalism whose instability and inequality are an affront to what we believe in, to our morality, to our religious commitments, and to the safety of our own lives and our future. And even that we could have tolerated, except one more thing. One more thing. In the 1970s, American capitalists, feeling quite powerful, they had destroyed the communists, destroyed the socialists, and the labor movement has been, as you, I assume you all know, on a 50-year decline, losing members and influence every year for 50 years. That's the truth. So none of it's there. So the capitalists in 1907 decided to do something to make a lot more money. You're living with that. Here we go. One. They looked around the United States and said, you know, we've had a 100-year struggle with American workers. And over that time, because of unions, they'd pushed up the wages. And American workers get paid pretty well, 1970s. But we don't have to do that anymore. With modern jet travel and with the internet, we can produce in China, in Brazil, in India. What are we paying high wages here for? We can produce there. The minimum wage in Bangladesh today for a garment worker, ready? $50 a month. That's by the way, why your underpants are the price they are. Well, it is. So capitalists began to leave. They're going to go where they can make more money. That's it. The second thing they discovered was a way to make more money was to bring, ready, cheap workers here. If it didn't work to put the factory out there, bring them here and pay them nothing. Preferably if they don't have documents, because then they're scared to death and they have to accept anything you do because they can't go to the police to complain. Bring them in, quick. And the third thing, now that the unions are broken, automate. Develop the computer, develop the robots. So the American working class, living in a capitalism that subjects them to instability and inequality, had another whack in the face. Job loss, because the companies leave. Wage pressure downward, immigrants coming in that are desperate and needy, and being replaced by automation. It's too much. And as a result, your wages go nowhere. And as a result, your organizations are weak. Why are American working class people loyal to a system that has treated them this way? It makes no sense. You don't need to be an ideologue. You explain this, I explain this to the American people, and they get it. No problem at all. What remains in the final part of what I have to tell you? What remains in my audiences, huge and multiple as they are, I've only given you a smattering of what I've been doing. The big question is, what can we do? What can we do about all this? How do you solve? Where do you even begin? So let me answer. There's something common to all of these things that is the problem we can solve. Who makes the decision, for example, to replace a worker with a machine, to move a factory from St. Louis to Shanghai, to take the bulk of the profits made by a group of workers and give them to a tiny number of people to create incredible wealth? Who makes these decisions and many more? It's a very simple answer. It's called the board of directors and the major shareholders of every corporation. That's who makes the decision. Let me remind you, for those of you not familiar with how capitalist business works. Most of you and I in this room, we go to work for a corporation of one kind or another. We are the employees. We come at 9 in the morning or whenever it is. We leave at 5. We do our job. We have our lunch in a big hurry. We go to the bathroom twice. You know. 5 out of 7 days. And then, and each night we go home And we're really thrilled about it. You know how we know we're thrilled about it? Because on the way home, we stop at a place which offers us a happy hour. Helping us to remember, in case we forgot, what was the different quality of the preceding 8 hours. For which we need that offset. And we stop and we lubricate, and then we go the rest of the way home. We do what we're told, don't we? We cross that threshold, and the boss says, sit there, work with that machine in that way. And when you're done using your brains and your muscles to produce whatever that company makes, your job is to get out of there. Get your coat and get out. You know what you produce? That's ours. That stays here. And if by mistake a stapler is in your pocketbook, you will lose your job. Which you know, which is why you put the stapler elsewhere. Right? No one in this room, but other people do that. Right? Who tells you where to sit? The board of directors. You know how the board of directors works? Every corporation has a board. This is the law. Every corporation has a board of directors. Typically 12 to 20 people. That's all. Very small. You know how you get to be on the board of directors? You have to be elected by the shareholders. That's how it's done. Every year, shareholders elect the board of directors. If you're not aware of that, that's because you're not one of them. Which may come as a shock, and I'm sorry to bring you this news, but you're not. And I can see from some of your faces, you just made a decision you're aiming at that. You hope to get to be that. Good luck to you. Here's how it works. Every share is one vote. So if you own no shares, that's how many votes you got. Zilch. Most workers in most factories have no shares. So they have no influence at all. Same in the office, same in the store. If you own 1 million shares, you get, ready, 1 million votes. Turns out that 1% of shareholders in America, 1% of shareholders own about 2/3 of the shares. In other words, that's the 1% that the Occupy people helped us understand. The 1% who decide who's on the board of directors. Here's what the board of directors decides. What the company produces, how the company produces, where the company produces, and here comes the good one, what to do with the profits that the company makes. That's how a company works. So let's review. The decision makers are the board of directors, 12 to 20 people. The major shareholders, 12 to 20 people, 24 people. How many folks work at General Motors? 100,000. Whoops. 100,000 people take orders. 100,000 people live with the results of decisions over which they have no authority whatsoever. A capitalist corporation is an anti-democratic institution, isn't it? There's no way out of this. It may come as a troubling thought to some of you, but there it is, staring you right in the face. And you accept it. And it's kind of remarkable, because if you think about it, where do adults spend most of their lives? At work, 5 out of 7 days, the best hours of the day. And if you're not working, you know, you're getting dressed and ready to go to work, or you're recuperating from work, or you're drinking as much beer as possible to get ready for the next day's work, all of that. So if you believe in democracy, I mean really, as opposed to verbiage, then the first place it would be instituted is at the workplace, because that's where you are more than any other place. But you live in a country which prates about democracy morning, noon, and night, and there isn't any where you spend most of your time, and there never was, and you didn't worry about it, did you? So stop talking about democracy on the 4th of July. You're a hypocrite at best. Wow. But this isn't just a question of democracy. Corporations decide, let's see, we've been making shirts and blouses and pants and socks here in St. Louis, but we're paying workers whatever. We're moving to Bangladesh, where we pay workers next to nothing. We're going to make a fortune. We'll sell the socks at maybe a little less than we used to, but the cost is way less, and we pick up the difference. There's no higher math here. And so they do something interesting. They move the factory. This has a lot of interesting effects. It wipes out 5,000 families in St. Louis who don't have a job anymore. The factory's gone. You're done. The neighborhood falls apart. The children have no place to play. You get the bit. You all know it's just a few miles from here. You can see it all. And you've been seeing it for decades, haven't you? But here's some more things that are results. When you produce socks in Bangladesh that you're wearing, you all know those socks have to come across the oceans, 10,000 miles from Bangladesh, which is about as far as you can get before you start turning around and coming back the other way. That means ships do something. What did they do? They dump crap in the water. They burn fossil fuels and foul the air. The pollution problem we have has been exacerbated because boards of directors could make more profit by making socks over there. And guess why this never bothers them? Because they don't have any costs. They don't have to clean up the ocean. They don't have to compensate the people who got asthma because of breathing that crap, or who eat tainted fish who swim in that crap. They don't have to, so for them it's profit. The costs of it all, we get to live those. That's stupid, folks. We are stupid to permit such things. But we let them do that. We give them the power to move the factory. No matter what the social cost, here's the best part. Every year at Christmas, the head of the board of directors has a Christmas party for the corporate employees. They all get together in a decorated room, and everybody drinks too much and kisses the wrong person in the wrong way. You know, Christmas joyness, right? And then the chairman of the board of directors gets up and makes a speech on wobbly legs because he's drunk. And he says, I want to thank all of you who all of you helped make this company profitable this year, and I appreciate it. And then he falls off the table. Okay? Now notice what he admits. Everybody in the company helped to produce the profits. But who decides what is done with the profits? The board of directors. Not the people who helped produce it, who have no say over it. And guess what? This is going to come as a real shock to many of you. What do you think the boards of directors and major shareholders do with the profits everybody helped to produce, but they decide how to use? They give a disproportionate portion of it to themselves, of course. That's why they have those high salaries. That's why they pay out in dividends a fat portion of the profits to the major shareholders. That's why there are rich people like Bill Gates, because that's how they distribute the wealth of the Microsoft Corporation. They give a lot to, you guessed it, him. Let's do it again. We all work, we all help to produce, we all contribute to the profits. How do we know that? The drunken chairman told us on Christmas. We know. But we have no say over it. No democratic control whatsoever over the fruits of our own labor. You know what that's like? That's like being a slave. We don't call you a slave, but you're a slave. Not a slave like African Americans in the South, but a slave like black and white people today who permit this crazy, crazy undemocratic outrage to persist. So what is the solution? Well, it kind of jumps out at you, doesn't it? The solution is to not permit this way of organizing the production of goods and services to continue. This crazy arrangement in which a tiny number of people with no democratic control can decide what to produce, how to produce, where to produce, and what to do with the profits. And the solution? Easy. Democratize the enterprise. Here's how it works. Every day, workers come to work, they do their work, And then once a week, once a month, it doesn't matter. The workers all get together and decide democratically what to produce, how to produce, where to produce, and what to do with the profits. And believe me, folks, you don't need to be a genius to understand. Suppose the question comes, should we close the factory in St. Louis and move to Shanghai? That would take the workers, I don't know, 6, maybe 7 seconds to decide. We ain't going anywhere. End of discussion. And why would the workers do that? Because they're not going to eradicate their own jobs, destroy their neighborhoods, screw their banks that lent them money, stop paying taxes to the community that pays for their schools. Come on, they're not going to do that. You wouldn't have had the exodus of American industry because they wouldn't have permitted it. End of story. And let's talk about distributing wealth. At the end of the year, the corporation has profits. If it's a worker collective, if it's democratically run, the workers all get together and decide how to distribute the wealth, the profits. You think they're going to give a few people billions of dollars while the average person can't send their kid to college? Not going to happen. They won't pay everybody the same. They'll have some differences, but nothing like what we have. You want to do something about inequality? Here's the solution. And folks, it's the only solution. You know how we know that? Because we tried everything else. We have every kind of tax arrangement, every kind of redistribution. We tear ourselves apart as a society over the redistribution of wealth. Mr. Trump and the Republicans tried from November 9th when he was elected to today to get rid of the Affordable Care Act, the Obamacare, in order to stop taxing wealthy people who had to pay for that. I don't know if you're aware of it, but the way that was paid for was by taxing people who earn over $200,000 a year, or couples that earn over $250,000. That's who had to pay for it. And that's why the Republicans went against it, because that's their patronage, that's their people, that's their support. And they were delivering to them what they had promised, a tax cut, a wonderful one on the rich. The rest of the conversation is irrelevant. And if that meant depriving 24 million people of coverage, blah, all the rest, the talk about mandates was all noise. We don't want to have a mandate telling us what to do. Americans, Fred, you know, bear with me. There's a law in this country for about 150 years. If you have a child, you're mandated to send them to school. And if you don't, we're going to arrest you. We managed to live with this mandate. Big mandate. If you have a car, you have to buy car insurance, or else we punish you. There's hundreds of mandates on us. Affordable care is just another one. The Republicans said, we don't want to have mandate. What? Where do you live? On the moon? What is this? It was about taxes. And today, it failed. We couldn't get it done. In part because millions of Americans kind of began to understand something about this is maybe good for the taxes of the rich who don't need it, and it's going to be taken out of the hides of poor people with medical problems. You know, maybe the wind is changing. Maybe people understand. But it's the same issue. Why do we permit? And you know what the rich folks at the board of directors, you know what they do is they accumulate wealth. They're not stupid. They know that they're accumulating wild amounts of wealth in a country that allows everybody to vote. That's very dangerous because it's only a matter of time before the mass of people decide, gee, we have the majority of the votes and we can take it away from them with the votes. We can undo with the votes what they've done with the economy. Whoa, let's try that. And because that's a danger, they have bought the political system, so we can't. That's what they did. And that's the logical thing for them to have done. They're using the money we give them that they take for themselves to prevent us from getting it. We are a joke. And believe me, there's plenty of people at the top who are enjoying the joke on us. The solution is to democratize the enterprise. To bring democracy to the enterprise and say, If the mass of people collectively in each enterprise made the decision of that enterprise, we wouldn't have the inequality we have today, we wouldn't have the loss of jobs, we would have a radically different economy, one that actually solved these problems rather than spinning our wheels, trying something that fails again, doesn't last. There it is, my final point. In case you're wondering, as I know people do when I say this, that this is a lovely idea, but it could never work, or it's beyond hope, or it never succeeds, I'm going to end by telling you where it is happening, so you know that this isn't a new idea, and this isn't pie in the sky. The most successful example of this is called the Mondragon Cooperative Corporation. It's the seventh largest corporation in Spain. It exists in the Basque region, which is the northern part of Spain. Here's the story, very quick. In 1956, a Catholic priest, Spain is a Catholic country, the Basque people are Catholics. So in 1956, a Catholic priest named Father Arizmendi makes a joke to his Catholic parish. If we all, they're all unemployed, it's very poor up there. If we wait for an employer to come here and give us a job, ha ha ha, we'll all die of old age before that happens. So let's hear what we do, he said. Let's become our own boss. We'll set up a business as a co-op. So under the protection of the Roman Catholic Church in Spain, Father Arizmendi sets up a co-op with six workers. Over the last 50, 60 years, that company has been very, very successful. That's why today it employs 100,000 people. It is the most successful cooperative, worker cooperative in the world today. It has its own university, it has its own bank. In the university, they teach courses open to anyone, anywhere, how to set up a co-op, how to finance a co-op, how to run a co-op, how to solve the problems of a co-op, how to coordinate among co-op, all of it. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. We don't have to start from scratch. It's all there. And if you didn't know that, that's your education, I guess. Sorry, but what can I do? Here are a couple of the rules of the co-op, Mondragon. Adopted by the workers together. Nobody can make more than 8 times what anybody else makes in any co-op. You know what the ratio in this country is? 300-1. CEO gets roughly 300-1 for a large corporation. There, nobody can get, guess what? They don't have inequality of income. Problem solved. Didn't take 40 years, didn't take lots of legislation. Bingo! You don't have to struggle over redistribution for a simple reason, because you didn't distribute it unequally in the first place. You know what we do? It's like this. It's like, I have 2 children. When my kids were young, occasionally my wife and I would take them out for ice cream. Now you have a choice if you get 2 ice cream cones. One thing you can do is give the 2 ice cream cones to 1 kid. And then you can give a lecture to that 1 kid about why he or she should redistribute the wealth to their sibling. So you can do that. This produces a level of sibling hostility that will haunt these people the rest of their lives. You can struggle over the redistribution. But most of you would understand there's a much better solution than coming up with a clever way to get them to redistribute. Like, look, dear, and snatch one away. That's a redistribution program. Here's the better way. Give each of them 1 cone, you idiot. Then there isn't a problem, is there? If you don't distribute the income unequally, you remove the need to fight each other over getting it redistributed because it's so unfair how you did it in the first place. Come on, these are not, that's what worker co-ops do. Let me give you a second example. In Italy, there's a whole region called Emilia-Romagna, a very famous part of Italy. In that part of Italy, co-ops are very successful. And co-ops do 40% of the business in that region of Italy. By the way, why would Italy have so many worker co-ops? Simple reason. There are many reasons, but here's a big one. 1985, in Italy, they passed a law. It's called the Marcora Law, the name of the Italian legislator who got it through. The law says if you become unemployed in Italy, you have 2 choices. The first choice is like what we do in this country. You can go and get a check for a year or so while you're unemployed. But you have a second choice. The second choice is this. If you get 9 other workers unemployed like you to do what I'm about to describe, to all do the same thing, here's what the government will do. We'll give you your entire
unemployment right up now as a lump sum today. And we'll do it for all 10 of you. On one condition, you use that money that we give you as the startup capital for a worker co-op. Huh? Been on the books now since 1985. Has it ever been proposed in the American Congress? No. Has it ever been discussed in the American Congress? No. How many of you knew about it? Don't raise your hands. Why don't you know about it? Well, it's the same story. All over the United States, there are worker co-ops. The biggest source of worker co-ops we now work with, and here it is, it may surprise you. It's not workers who want it. There are plenty of those who are doing that. But what's coming to us at Democracy at Work in New York are the following. 60 to 70 year old American couples who started a business 30 years ago, who did it well, who accumulated their business, and they're now 60, 65 years of age, and they don't want to do this business anymore. They want to travel. They want to see the world. And their children have other lives and don't want to continue in that business. So they've got 66 employees, to pick an example, and they're in Sheboygan, up in the north, and they're upset. What can they do? They could close the factory. They don't want to do that. That's their life work. They developed that thing. They're proud of their little baby business. Plus, they don't want to destroy the lives of those 66 people. So they don't want to close it. Well, they could sell it to another business. But they don't want to do that for the same reason. They don't know what that other business is going to do next week, next month. And they could go public. They could sell shares and give it to... But again, it's the same problem. So they're agonized. What are they going to do? We arrive. And we say, hey, we got a solution for you. Sell your business to your own workers. Let them continue it as a worker co-op. They keep their jobs. The town keeps the business. The taxes keep getting paid to the community. It's the solution you want. It's the only solution that's secure for you. Well, you convinced them. But now the only problem that remains is the problem, how are they going to get the money, the workers, to buy this thing? Well, here's the solution that they have come up with in England. England, which is way ahead of us on this. England has something called the Labour Party. It's the number two party there. The Conservatives are in power, the Liberals are the outs, like Republican and Democrat. The head of the Liberal Party looks like, sounds like, and is like Bernie Sanders. The difference is, he won. Jeremy Corbyn.
Yes,
name you should remember. Jeremy Corbyn is the new head of the Labour Party. About a year he's been ahead of it. Here's the plan of the Labour Party, folks. The plan of the Labour Party, if we win the next election, which I believe is next year in England, we become the government, then they have a perfectly good chance. The law, we will pass a law, and here's what the law will say. Any business in England that's now existing can continue the way it is. But if and when that business says it's thinking of closing down, or if and when that business is saying it is going to put itself up for sale to another business, or if and when that business decides to become a public company with shares and all of that, the law will say before a business can do any of that, it must offer what's called the right of first refusal to its own workers to buy the business. They have to do that. And now comes the best part. And where is the, are the workers in every enterprise going to get the money to do it? And Mr. Corbyn smiles and says the British government will lend it to them at a very low interest rate. And why? Because we are going to build in England a worker co-op sector of our economy. Everywhere. Everywhere. We're going to give the British people freedom of choice. If you want to go to work in a top-down capitalist undemocratic enterprise, be free to do it. But if you'd like to work in a democratically run enterprise, we're going to give you that choice. By the way, that's a choice that Americans don't have, because we don't have that sector yet. We're going to be able to buy from a worker co-op or for a capitalist enterprise. You can choose. You can use your dollar to buy a shirt from one or the other. Make your buying power vote. So it's already happening around the world. And worker co-ops are a real, live, existing thing. The only amazing thing is why we don't do it. And the American people will support this in huge numbers. You know why? Because in a way, and this is my closing comment, what I'm proposing, I'll be honest with you, this is what socialism is going to mean in the 21st century. It isn't going to be about the government taking things over. It's not going to be about that. It's not going to be the government planning and the government. Not going to be about that. Maybe secondarily, but not primarily. Primarily, it's going to be about a transformation in the daily work life of the American people. You're going to be a worker in a business you own and control in a democratic way with everybody else. And that's going to give you a better life. Everybody's going to have two job descriptions: the particular task you do and your role in running the enterprise. You're not going to have a choice, just like you don't have a choice. Oh, you want this job, you have to do these tasks. Well, you want this job, you have to do these tasks, which includes being a self-managed, self-directed worker enterprise. Wow. It's going to change all of us, our lives. We're not going to be as docile politically because we have practice every day in running our lives at work. We're not going to let other people do that in the community anymore either. And we're going to have the skills and the techniques to make decisions collectively. We're going to have a democracy that's real finally because we did what we were never willing to do before: make the economic system as democratic as we would like the political system to be. That's going to be a demand for socialism that's going to surprise our conservative enemies, because they're expecting an advocacy of socialism that's all about the government. We're going to fool them. This is an advocacy for socialism that comes from below, that begins where we all live our lives, and it will capture the American people with an enthusiasm of a socialism that means my life changes from tomorrow. I'm not waiting for a government to do it. I'm doing it, just like everybody else will be doing. It's a vision and an image of a changing the society to make it stop being the unstable, unequal mess that we're in now. So we've done it. We've analyzed capitalism for its fundamental unacceptability, and we have offered a solution. And you know what that means? That means a level of maturity of the left in America. We've reached the ability to present clear, cogent critiques of the system and a clear, cogent alternative. That's all that we need to do. Now the tech task is go out there and recruit the people who share this vision. Will it be everybody? No, of course not. But it will be more than enough to move this country in directions no one has moved them for at least half a century. And again, this is now possible. That's why I have the nerve to say it to you in front of cameras that are going to repeat this everywhere. Do I look worried? I'm not. And I'm a cautious person. I would not be saying this to you if I thought it was dangerous. I'm not that courageous. But I've taken the chance. I'm the one the camera's on. All you have to do is go out there, think about this, and add your own component to making it happen. These can be incredibly, powerfully exciting times in the years ahead. And you can tell from my hair, I've been around a while. And I travel a lot, and I work hard. But I have to be honest with you in conclusion. And you could be able to tell it from looking at me. I'm having the time of my life. Thank you very much.
So if you have to leave, do so quietly, because we're going to take some questions. So who's got
here's the microphone.
Oh, great. Okay, so Spencer's... Okay. Go.
Yeah, I can hear. When you were speaking towards the end, when you were talking about what you what could be, the room looked really quiet and people had stretched up looks on their faces. Why? That's a question for you if you've seen it. I mean, is it because of the education that we are so afraid of change?
No, I don't.
So afraid of corporations and, you know, the power of all this?
No, I don't think we're so afraid of change and I don't think we're so afraid of corporations. I think we're afraid of standing up and doing this. That's why I told the story about the crushing of the left after World War II. I think that's in our psyches, deeply down. It's dangerous, but I'm gonna use a couple of metaphors to try to get it across. I had two children, a son and a daughter. I have two children, a son and a daughter. And when my daughter reached puberty, like all parents, we began to wonder, how do we explain to her that sometimes the outfits she was getting on to go into the city got us nervous? You know, you don't want to be a fuddy-duddy, and you don't want to, you know, some of you have been in that situation. So how do you, well, we did our best. I'm sure it was mixed in the quality. Well, my daughter, who's much older now, and who is, by the way, a psychotherapist, perhaps because of how we didn't do it well, who knows. But she has talked to me often, now that she's a professional in this area, that how deep into the psyche of young women these difficult messages work. How years later she would go to buy a blouse and she'd go into the dressing room and try it on, look in the mirror, and if it had a certain look, she, even though she liked it, she'd put it away because it was that look that her mother gave her to understand and not a good idea. Don't do that. It's like that. It's this deep, unformed, inchoate, vague feeling. You know, there's these left-wing people and they're handing out a leaflet and they're calling for a meeting. And you know, I'm kind of interested, but you need to go to a meeting and, maybe somebody will see me, maybe someday somebody will remember that I was at that. And suddenly they don't go. They go bowling instead, or they watch TV, or they, you know, and they're not even aware. But it's a kind of anxiety. I'll be the only one. I'll stand out. I will be tarred with a brush. It's vague. But that's my sense. We have to overcome it. We have to get together and discover we are a lot stronger than we think. We are in less danger than we used to be. Look, we have a government right now that is spending a great deal of its time and money going and hunting down Muslims. Not us. People with a bomb in their shoe. Not us. We have space. We really do. And we have millions of people who want something. Millions of people decided that a man who accepted the label socialist, which was a death sentence for a political person for the last half century, Mr. Sanders, 13 million people of fellow Americans voted for him. They weren't upset by socialists. It's not what it was. That's why I work at that. It's not the way it was. I travel everywhere, all over the country. I've been doing it for 4 years. My meetings have the feeling and the spirit that they do tonight. Yes. I look at you. I've been a teacher all my life. I can see if I'm boring the audience or if they're all wondering when they can get the hell out of here, et cetera, et cetera. I can see. I know what I've got. I got people that are engaged with this. They may have crunched up faces, but they're thinking about it. See, they've not left. You know, even those that are giggling, I can see they're giggling at the right moment. I'm getting it across. So I think it's this vague fear. I don't know how exactly you undo that, And remember, it's been sitting here for 40, 50 years. That's a long time. Your grandmother gave it to your mother, and your mother gave it to you, and your father, and your uncle, and there. And every family has a story to tell about Uncle Louie over there and back in the 50s. And then he went, and somebody said they saw him at a... You hear, these are stories that become part of the lore of every family. There they are. There they are. So that's my guess, sir.
Okay, so if anyone's interested in forming worker co-ops, please let me know, or let someone at KKFI know, and they'll let me know. We're looking for businesses. Already have city council people that are interested in promoting it, and also people with the STAR. And the second thing, if anyone wants to form a book club, let me know. I mean, after you've read the book and you want to talk to other people, we can coordinate this with KKFI also.
Yes, good. And we'll help from New York City and Democracy at Work. We'll help work with Mike and others to help you do that, to build. That's what we're doing all over the country. I should mention, Democracy at Work now has active groups in 15 cities across the United States. The most recent one, the addition in Phoenix, Arizona. But we have them in Los Angeles, and New York City, and San Francisco, Tampa, Florida, and all kinds of places where people are beginning to become active. You should be aware also that two city councils, one in Madison, Wisconsin, and one in New York City, have now allocated $2.5 million in New York, $5 million in Madison, Wisconsin, to help develop worker co-ops in those communities as part of the economic development of those cities. In fact, we're working on that all over the country. We're becoming a political advocacy forum to push for this kind of thing. And we have all the arguments that I've just kind of summarized for you as to why this is appropriate and why this is necessary. And I've appeared before city councils, and I've talked to congressmen and senators. I can tell you this, as they like to say in Washington, this proposal has legs. It has some traction. It moves because it's new and it's different, and it offers concrete examples like the Mondragon or Italy or...
Port towns in Washington, where the food co-op, in port towns in Washington is bigger than any grocery store there.
Right, and co-ops are all of all different kinds. We focus on worker co-ops, but consumer co-ops like the food co-ops around the country, credit unions, which are basically co-op bank type of situation. There's a lot of this. This is very old in the United States. If any of you wanted to see an example, by the way, of an early American co-op, very profound worker co-op, then go up to Pittsfield, Massachusetts, unless you have nearby communities. The Shakers, you all know the history of the Shaker movement. Are you with me? The Shaker. It's an early American Protestant religious community who, I think this is okay to say, right? It's not a church. Okay, they didn't believe in sex. So that's why they shook. They got together and everybody, seriously. Hold it. It's not meant to be comedic. They had shaking ceremonies where they discharged the energy that you might otherwise have discharged in another way. And as somebody I heard someone say, well, this makes problems for the long-term survival of this group. How did they've existed to this day, so they obviously solved that problem. You might be interested to know how they solved it. Starting in colonial days, Shaker communities, and if you ever want to go to Pittsfield, Massachusetts, there is a continuing Shaker community that will take you through like a museum and show you what a worker co-op was and how successful it was. Here's what they did back in colonial days. They let it be known that any woman seeking to escape an abusive relationship with a man, presumably her husband, could come at any time of night and day, with or without her children, to a Shaker community, and with no questions asked, she would be taken in, so would her children, they would be clothed, they would be fed, they would be housed, and no information about them to any authority would be made available. That's how they survived. This was the first American abused woman program, or battered woman shelter type program. Okay, the Shakers did that. What an interesting story. And you know how they did it? They integrated those women immediately into the worker co-op to help develop, and they made the decisions in common, what to produce, how to produce, where to produce, and how to share. I mean, they did it all within the framework of their Christian rituals and beliefs, but who cares? You know, there are nuns and monks in the Roman Catholic Church who collectively produce jams and all kinds of other stuff in a collective way like this.
Fudge,
you name it. But the point is, these are old human beings have tried to develop collective, cooperative enterprise for a long time. I think now its historic moment to become a general way is here. And I think the religious folks may surprise us because they may see in this a way to make the religious commitments they have actually mean something in daily life rather than be those funny things we say on Sunday before we go back to our real lives and live them in a way that is contradicted by the stuff we do on Sunday. Yeah.
One thing that I remember hearing from about you on one of your podcasts is that you have a lot of French relatives. And with the upcoming election in France, and the fact that there are two socialist candidates, we're lucky enough here to get one, I just wanted to know if there was one that you support, or if there were any ideas of these candidates that you particularly liked, Benoît Hamon and Jean-Luc Mélenchon, if there's either one that you particularly like, or another candidate altogether.
Yes, well, my father was born in France. I speak French, I have all my life. And I have relatives in France, so I keep up with it. And I like to talk about France because it's a way for me to provoke Americans.
We need their healthcare.
Yeah.
I'm going to give you three examples. And once again, if you don't know what I just tell you now, that's another quality of your education system. Here's the law in France. You are covered for your medical insurance from the day you are born to the day you die. End of story. And that's been true for many decades. So what Americans can't figure out how to do, the French, and they're not the only ones in Europe, but most Europeans are like this, have solved. Number two, when you enter the labor force in France, you graduate high school, or if you go on for more, you graduate college. When you enter the labor force, the law in France says that your employer must give you 5 weeks of paid vacation every year.
Right
on. Do you understand that? Most of you will not get 5 weeks of paid vacation ever. They get it starting when a 19-year-old who's finished high school, that's what they get. And when you ask them why, they say, because anything else would not be a livable life. A human being needs to have time off. If you're married, you need to have time to work out your relationship with your partner. If you have children, you need to be able to give them the kind of undivided attention that you can never do when you're working a regular job. For them, the notion that Americans don't have this care, look forward to it, and that millions of Americans now have now jobs, that have no vacation at all, they don't believe it when I say it. They don't believe it. Here's another example. In France, if you have more than one child, if you have a second child, you get a subsidy from the government for every child after number one to help you pay for the cost of feeding and clothing and schooling the child. It's an obligation of the government to help you so that having children doesn't become a burden financially because it'll undermine your affection, your love, your care. Does it strike you as reasonable? It should.
And they also get help to clean the house.
Yes, you have another example. You have many, many weeks of paid maternal leave for the husband and the wife. You get it? Maternal paid leave, paternal paid leave, because a child should have access to the father too. Ha, whoa, what a weird idea. I could go on for a long time. Ask yourself whether the American working class knows this. They don't. And ask yourself whether that's an accident. It isn't. Now the French political scene. Why do the French have this? Because they have a powerful left that was never crushed after World War II. The effort was made, it didn't work. So for example, they have two left-wing parties now. They have the French Socialist Party, and they have a more an anti-capitalist for the left party. The French socialist, just for those of you who may not know, is now the government. The president of France is a socialist party leader, and the National Assembly, which is the most powerful of the two houses, is dominated by the socialist party. So the socialists are running a candidate, a left-wing candidate. The anti-capitalist, Mélenchon, is a further left party. The two together, they don't run together, they're two separate parties. But if you put together the polls that the two get, they get more than Marine Le Pen, who's the candidate of the far right. If you read American newspapers, you wouldn't get that. If you read the polls, you see it right away. That's why they have these things, because the unions and the communists and the socialists and et cetera, and that have fought for these things, and they make it too difficult to undo them. Even right-wing politicians dare not touch this. No candidate is saying, we shouldn't have 5 weeks paid vacation, we should only have 4. And you know why they don't? Because they would lose all their votes. It's over. So they don't dare. They don't take away any of this. 4 years ago, I was in France. I go to visit my family. I'm in France. It's in May. The French in May have to go into the streets and demonstrate about something. It's just part of who they are. So if you want to be in a demonstration in France, go in May, there'll be one, or 6. So it was May, and there was a demonstration. Why? Because the government, it was not yet the socialists, the government had proposed to cut back the free daycare that is provided to French citizens in Paris. And it turns out that many of the daycares are located in the basements of Catholic churches. And the government pays a rental to the church for having the daycare center there. I mean, you have that in the United States too. So anyway, the conservatives made a bill to slash these subsidies for these daycare centers. So the French immediately said, into the streets, this is no good, and the Communist Party led it. So we come out of our hotel, and there's a demonstration, and my wife and I have the general view that there's a demonstration, we go. Okay? Afterwards we ask, what was it about? Well, we're so eager to have the United States be a place that does this that we just need to get into it when there is one. So we go out, we go in, and we start talking about, before we get very far, we notice something. Leading the demonstration is, the city of France is divided into districts, and the names of these districts is called arrondissement. It's the name of the sector. And so the flags of the people at the head of the demonstration are all red. It's the Communist Party chapter of the 8th arrondissement. Okay? Well, that makes a certain sense. Communists will go out of their people. Right behind them, the Church of Saint Xavier. 10 nuns carrying Church of Saint Xavier. But the only thing that was odd was the nuns were arm in arm with the communists. That's France. They all know each other. That church is right next to the communists. They have lunch every day. And the government, taking a look at the fact, if you're opposed in France by the communists and the church, you're done. It's over. And the government withdrew the bill. I can see from your faces, let me give you a lesson in European politics. Every Italian family, every French family, every Spanish family, every Portuguese family, and most Greek families have in them a communist. You know who the communist is? It's Aunt Louise, the one who makes those really good sandwiches when we have picnics. It's the one that your nephew ran to when he hurt his knee and he fell off his bicycle. He ran to Aunt Louise because she's so nice and warm. When you say to a population like that, watch out for the communist, everybody goes, what the hell are they talking about? Communist? That's Aunt Louise. She never heard a flea. She's my best friend. You can't demonize because everybody knows one or two. And they're just like, you and me. You can't do it. As it doesn't go in those countries. That's why people keep voting for socialism, communism, because it's your neighbor, it's the guy who makes the coffee for you, it's your coworker, it's your relatives. Demonize them? You just dropped off your children at their house. What are you going to tell me? I'm in danger? I'm not in danger. You're crazy. This makes it very dangerous for political movements. The United States is a place where you could demonize because you got rid of them first, made them very distant, very strange, very, and now you can tell them anything. Because there's no counterweight in the cult. You can't do that. By the way, Portugal, why did I include Portugal? Little detail, another example of what you may not know. The government of Portugal today is a coalition of three political parties. The Portuguese Socialist Party, the Portuguese Green Party, and the Portuguese Communist Party. That's the government of Portugal. It's been that way for a couple of years. And if you didn't know that, gee, maybe it's because the New York Times doesn't mention it. Except at the end of a 27-column story, right next to the advertisement for handbags. But I didn't make that up. Just look it up, you'll see.
So you mentioned what the U.S. did here in the U.S. to wipe out socialism, communism, but also in Europe. It seems like a lot of our money was spent through the CIA in the 50s, 40s and 50s and 60s to try to wipe out socialism, communism there. Could you give some insight into that?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the historical, you know, we have there's a 50-year rule in the United States State Department government documents. You can only release documents after 50 years. That's a rule in part because the assumption is that the people mentioned in these documents have now died or gone on, and so you can begin. Not everything is released, but there's a kind of a general, called a 50-year rule. So it's now about, you know, half a century since the post-war period, and it turns out, yes, the United States government was financing anti-socialist, anti-communist movements, political parties. You know what we were doing? We were interfering in every single election. The thing that we're so angry that the Russians are doing, they really shouldn't do that. That's an American obligation. Not for other countries. How nasty of them, how outrageous that they should do to us what we do and have been doing for half a century across the world. But don't tell anybody I said that.
Not to count the coups.
I know in a previous update you mentioned how some of the big banks have put out a red alert on the stock market. I wonder if you could comment on our current economic outlook, and does Mondragon give tours, I wonder?
Yes, Mondragon will give you a tour. You just get, they have a big, they're missionaries. They want to help develop worker co-ops all over the world. Not only that, there are American groups that regularly take people on those tours. If you're interested, you know, talk to me at the end. I'll give you the name of them. Multiple people are doing this. By the way, some of you may be interested, there's another experiment in building worker co-ops going on right now, much closer than Spain. It's in Cuba. The Cuban government decided about 4 years ago to change the direction of socialism, building socialism in Cuba, before Castro died, Fidel Castro died. The decision was, we're not going to rely on government enterprise, government the way we have been doing. We're changing to focus our future on worker co-ops. And the Cuban government is creating them and subsidizing them and building them. And if you want to see that, which you can now do because we have diplomatic relations with Cuba, airlines fly there all the time, and there's no prohibition on Americans going there. And the Cubans also offer trips to go. The University of Rhode Island, I happen to know, regularly takes students and interested people to Cuba, where they have a relationship to allow students that are interested from the University of Rhode Island to go there. There are other people that go to Mondragon and so on. There's no problem at all. They are eager to show you what you're doing, and obviously, if you go to Mondragon or Cuba, it would be better if you spoke Spanish, because then you can have direct interactions with those people, ask them what they feel about it, experiences they've had, and directly interact with them.
Okay, first off, I want to say I went to Mondragon and I interviewed them, and I did it, I translated it into English.
Even better.
And if you go to the Heartland Labor Forum webpage, you go back to mid 2015, you can find that show.
Good.
All right, and learn about it. We're going to take one more question from Greg, and then I have a final question. And then if you have questions, I'm sure
Rick will stay around for a few minutes afterwards. But I also want to say we have two books left, and of his book, and so if you'd still like to purchase one, please do. We don't want to send them back to the publisher. So, Rick.
You mentioned co-op banks, and given the political climate that we have right now, I'm really wondering whether anything could get past, you know, where the government would be financing that sort of thing. So I was wondering if you might describe, are there successful co-op banks and how that might aid what's being done here, you know, in terms of financing co-ops?
Okay, two quick answers. I don't need to tell you because you all know that a government dominated by Mr. Trump as president by the Republican Party in both houses means that getting something progressive through there is, you know, a rich man through the eye of the needle and all that. Brian, I can't comment. I have nothing to offer that you don't already know about the difficulty or the long shot nature of doing anything like that. What I can tell you is even Republicans, if you light a fire, a political fire under their rear ends, will begin to move because it's hot and they don't want to be burnt. And that's what we're in the business of doing. So let me answer the question about co-op banks. Well, first let me explain to you that in the United States we have co-op banks. They're called credit unions. A credit union is a cooperative bank. It's where a group of people, usually at a workplace, that's where it mostly starts, get together and say, instead of putting my paycheck in a bank downtown, I'm going to put my paycheck into the credit union, and I'm going to, you know, write my checks and have my credit card the way I do at a regular bank. But when I make a loan, I will pull my money. And so what it is everybody who works there being a cooperative bank. So we don't need to start from zero. We already have that. If you're not aware of it, the big banks in America have been very frightened by co-ops, credit unions. So they have passed lots of legislation that limit what credit unions can do. That's why they aren't much bigger than they already are. And there are about 100 million Americans, roughly a third of Americans, that have something to do with a credit union. So it's already very big. But they are not allowed to make certain kinds of loans. They are not allowed to do because the big banks don't want the competition from them. That could be changed by political effort, and that would allow them to offer many more services, which would make them even more competitive to the private bank that most of us are now relying on, number one. Number two, many European countries have had cooperative banks for decades. Most savings banks in Germany are co-op banks, because the Germans, this will come as a shock. They don't want and they don't allow private banking and savings. They don't allow it. They won't have it. In fact, we don't allow a private fire department, do we? You want fire protection? You call the fire department. What fire department? The government fire department. You can choose not to call them, but then you're going to have trouble with your house. So you call them. We live with it. We don't have private police, although we have a little of that. We don't have much of that. Most of us don't allow private parks to replace our public parks, and we limit the private beaches so we have access to the beach, and on and on. And they've just made banking part of it. It's too important for the economy, it has too many social effects to leave it in the hands of institutions whose first priority is private profit. Really ask yourself, this is an economics question. Does it make sense for something that the whole society needs and relies on, like the money supply, being able to earn money and spend money and store money, all the ways we use money, does it make sense when we all depend on it to put the control of it into the hands of an institution whose first priority is to make a profit for itself? It's not rational to do that. It's good for the private banks.
Oh, the Fed? Is that what you're talking about?
No, I'm talking about private banks.
Okay, private.
Private banks, for those of you who don't know, and you should because this is called modern monetary theory and its home is UMKC, somewhere in a place which explains to the profession that money is created by private banks, because when you go to get a loan from a private bank, they create a checking account for you. Bingo. Can they do that whenever they want? Uh-huh. Are they limited in that? Not really.
They just do that. Okay, that's very interesting. But you're now putting the question of how much money there is in circulation in the hands of people who make a decision that impacts the entire monetary system based on what's profitable for themselves. You're not, that's not a smart way of doing things, is it? Come on. These are not complex issues. So the answer is, there are co-op banks around the world. They would meet, by the way, I've met these people whose economists come to conferences I go to. They would be happy to share their 50-year history of cooperative banking with Americans who wanted to do it. It's a little bit strange, let me end with this, it's a little bit strange to explain this to an American audience. You just saw, over the last 4 years, the biggest banks in America be either found guilty in the courtroom or guilty in government regulations of violating our trust in every activity they do. Let me go through it. Big banks have been caught and had to pay billions in fines for laundering money, knowingly handling criminals' money to enable that criminal enterprise to succeed financially. They've been caught manipulating global interest rates, a so-called LIBOR scandal, where they got caught. They've been manipulating foreign exchange rates. They recently got caught at that. They mishandled the mortgage crisis in 2008 and had to pay big things. And they've overcharged you for everything from bounced checks to everything the banks do, they stole from us. And what is the constant discussion in the United States? Rules and regulation. We already had rules and regulation. It didn't work. More of them? You gotta be kidding. They got around them, they evaded them, they undid them. In the case of Glass-Steagall, they literally repealed them. Stop. Why in America is nobody saying, let's see, every single big private bank has ripped us off in every business that it does. Maybe we shouldn't have private banks.
Yeah.
And for those of you who don't know, we have a model for how to not have private banks. Because one out of the 50 states in the United States doesn't allow private banks to function for the state. It's a state that takes all of the money, all the taxes paid by the people in that state in the 50, all the hunting licenses purchased, all the car licenses purchased, all the permits to put a dog run in your town, all that money is given to this state, which deposits it in the public bank owned and operated by the state, thereby saving millions every year that they would have otherwise paid to First National Bank or Citibank or Wells Fargo or any other big ones. This state in the United States has done that, run its own public bank for the last 100 years.
North Dakota.
That's right. The Bank of a really typical progressive American state. North Dakota. The farmers and folks in North Dakota have not let any governor, Republican or Democrat, touch it. They have repulsed every effort by the big banks to get rid of that. The people of North Dakota love the bank that serves them. And when the end of the year comes and the bank shows its profits from taking in deposits and making loans, the Bank of North Dakota takes the profits and gives it to the state of North Dakota, which owns it. And therefore, the state of North Dakota charges less taxes to its people because it doesn't have to raise as much money in taxes because it saves all of that and takes the profits of its bank as part of the revenue for the state government. Does it sound reasonable to you?
Yes.
Yes. That's why you don't know about it.
He's on Kansas.
If the North Dakotans can get away with it, what's wrong with Missouri?
Or Kansas.
Or Kansas.
What happened to
you? Okay, one last question. I want to thank you all for coming, first off, and keep listening. Keep giving us your ideas for KKFI. We want feedback from the community. And keep supporting KKFI. Okay, I don't want to get charged with bait and switch. And we titled this talk because you said you'd do it. The Trump economic plan. So do you want to give us just, I know sure. It's early in the administration. I know that the media persists in calling him a populist. So what the hell is he as far as his economic plan? Or does he even have one?
Yeah, sure, he does. Good. I'll try to be as brief as I can. As you know, Mr. Trump upended the Republican Party by defeating all the traditional candidates that they had put up, many of them perennial candidates, and came out of, I was about to say left field, but I'll say right field, to become the Republican nominee, and then basically did the same thing to the Democratic Party establishment, pushed them aside, and so here he is. What that means is he comes into office with two enormous deficits. He doesn't have the support of the Republican Party, not really, they don't like him, and he doesn't have the support of the Democratic Party, they hate him too. Okay, this is difficult for a person to become the president with so little support. He got a lot of votes, but it's not clear how strong that support is. So his economic plan, such as it is actually disguised as the more important priority for Mr. Trump. He's got to find and build support, and he's got to do it in a hurry, because he risks being isolated as the kind of weirdo it's kind of easy to portray him as, and with his enemies in the Republican Party and his enemies in the Democratic Party and a population that, remember, he was elected with roughly 17-18% of the total eligible voters in America who voted for him. That's all it took to win in the general election. So his first priority can't be this or that. He's got to build support or else he's dead. So step number, but it has economic implications. Step number one, he's got to make sure that the people who could bounce him out of office, and I know this is difficult for Americans who don't think like this, but in every other country you do, and we have to catch up. So the first thing he has to do is make sure that the people who could bounce him out of office in 10 minutes won't do it. That's why he gives $50 billion to the military. That solves that problem. The military didn't even ask for it. You have nothing to worry about. I'm giving you more money than Jesus has. Here we go. Boom. No question. Do whatever the hell you want with it. Here it is. To fight against ISIS. Oh, yeah, sure. Fine. I'll say anything. You say it. Who cares? I'm your friend. Don't mess with me. Problem solved. Number two, curry favor with the Republican Party and the Republican Party base. The wealthy people who are the overwhelmingly dominant supporters, financially, of the Republican Party. How do you do that? There are two ways to do that. Number one, get rid of Obamacare. Why? Because it's a tax on the rich that paid for it. By getting rid of Obamacare, you drop the tax on the rich, and that's what it's about. And he can deliver to that important base an enormous prize, because it's big money that they had to come up with. I mean, these are very rich people, so for them it isn't a lot, but it's a lot of money compared to what they had thought they would have to pay. And since they were all covered with health insurance, they don't basically want to pay for a lot of people's health insurance. Very American, very nice. So what do? You get rid of Obamacare. Number three, you cut the corporate income tax from 35%, his proposal, 15. That's a hefty cut. Maybe 20 will be a compromise. That's saying to the entire business community, I'm your friend. I'm gonna cut your taxes like there's no tomorrow. Number four, I'm going to really, really have an infrastructure. I'm gonna build roads and bridges and harbors and all of that stuff, and that's going to be fat contracts for many of you. This is so the business community loves him. The financiers in Washington, New York and Washington love him. He's giving them an Easter basket full of colored eggs, of the sort they like, tasty ones. Tax reduction, regulation reduction, infrastructure building. Get rid of Obamacare. It's a wonderful thing. So there, he got that. He's got that. Now we get to the hard part. He's going to bring back jobs and good incomes to the mass of the American people. And here what we get is blah, 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 blah. We get nothing.
We get theater. We get an afternoon tweet every day that provokes us into hysterical yellings and screamings about something that we can all get excited about, and have 4 days of endless, boring news programs to watch on television with details that, you know, become foggy in our brain, because in the end, we kind of somewhere know this is all theater. Let me give you just two or three little examples. One, I'm going to put a tariff on those goods from China and Mexico, and so they'll be very expensive, you see, and then we won't, Americans won't want to buy them because they're so expensive, because I put a big tax on them, and so they'll be produced here in America because it'll be cheaper to make them here than to pay high tariff taxes on bringing them in, and that'll make jobs in America. Sounds plausible. If you hand this in to an economics professor, you get a large F. Let me explain to you why. One, if you did this, if you put these tariffs on China, I'm going to start, but I'm going to scare you now, but you asked. You are attacking China. You are declaring war on China. Why? Over the last 30 years, 400 million people have been moved off the countryside of China in its rural areas to the coastal areas from Beijing in the north to Hong Kong in the south. They are all working in factories that produce exports for North America and Western Europe. They can't go back. There's no place for them. There's no work in the rural areas they can get. They have to stay working. And if you put a tariff, you're closing them off. And that is an attack on the Chinese society. There's no work for them, they die. They will turn against their Communist Party government, and you will have a catastrophe in a country with nuclear weapons. You really want to do that? Really? Not gonna happen. And Mr. Trump will have to twist and tweet himself into oblivion. Can't be done. Second example, you want to do that to Mexico. Mexico is already a society that's half in the bag. There are large parts of Mexico that the Mexican government does not control. I assume you know that. Mexico has lived for the last 20 years off of two crucial things. The ability to take Mexicans who cannot work in that country because there's no work and send them to North America where there is. And when they get to North America, these Mexican immigrants take a huge portion of what they earn and they send it back to their families. This solves Mexico's problem. It gets rid of people it can't employ and has an enormously important export money coming in that can't get any other way. Right now, you are threatening with your immigration policy and your tariffs to kill him. That puts on your southern border a collapsed society. We're not going to be reading about the disasters of Iraq and Afghanistan that are 10,000 miles away. We're going to be reading about them in some place you can go in a few hours in your car. Think about it. That's not a viable option. You can't do that. Well, I'm not done. What will Americans do if there are tariffs? You can't buy the stuff unless you pay very much higher prices because you got to pay a tariff, and Mr. Trump does that. It means your shirt, your socks, your sandals, your toaster, it's all gonna jump up, huge price. You know what that does to your standard of living with your wages? You know what that's gonna do to the American people? It's gonna make them very angry. And you know what they're gonna do? They're gonna go to their employer and say, you've gotta give me more wages. I'm eating cat food here, and I don't like cat food. And I'm gonna make your life unpleasant. The employers of America want to have a mass uprising of the working class to get the money to simply keep their standard of living, to match the prices that are going up because the government raised the tariffs. You know what corporations are going to do when that begins to kick in? They're going to turn on Mr. Trump and they're going to say things about him that are more vulgar than what he says about other people. He can't do these things. He can't do them. And that's why it's theater. And that's why it's tweets, and that's why it's noise, because what he's delivering and offering to the working class is blah, blah. He can't do it. He can't do it.
General Motors won't go for it either.
Nobody's gonna go for it. And if it actually worked by some miracle, which I can't foresee, it's always possible, It would mean that Americans would now get these jobs. Americans demand much higher wages than what we've been paying in Bangladesh or Mexico or China. Americans would demand much higher wages. You know what that creates as an incentive? This is how capitalism works. If the worker becomes more better paid, with each increase in the wages of the worker, you've created a bigger incentive for the capitalist to replace the worker with a machine, whether it's a computer or a robot. That's the way capitalism works. The more successful the working class is in raising its standard of living, the greater the incentive for the capitalist to deprive the worker of his job. If that strikes you as an awful bind to be in, well, that's why we're against capitalism, because that's how it works. You know this, but you've been hesitant to put these pieces together. He can't. So even if he did it, and if the wages went up, the next response of the business community would be to robotize this stuff right out of existence. We're stuck. We live in a system in which capitalists have learned to use moving the job abroad, bringing the cheap labor here, and robotizing everything. And whenever you black off one, they'll do the other, because that's what the nature of profit-driven business is. So Mr. Trump has a good economic plan to win over the military, to win over the financial community, to win over the business community with big spending, like on the business, for the infrastructure and the military, with deregulation so they can do whatever the hell they want, and with tax cuts. He's got a good plan to build, by the way, a very traditional Republican support base. The stuff for the masses is more theater. He gave them the theater they wanted during the election. I'm different, I'm tough, vote for me, not these old machines that you know are not gonna help you. He's now gonna demonstrate to the American people that he does exactly what the Republicans have always done, and what they're gonna get is nothing. And for me, as an observer, here's the question that ought to scare you. It's not what he's doing now. It's when the American people, which could happen in a month, or 6 or 12, when they figure out what I just told you, that this was all a scam, they are gonna turn on that man with an anger, a sense of betrayal, a bitterness that is gonna make him twitch. Not tweet, twitch. Okay? And that's the danger point. What is he gonna do then? When the babble doesn't work, he has to come up with something else that will distract us. And here's some candidates. War.
Yeah, war is number one.
War is an old one. Here's another one. Ratchet up the scapegoating. Maybe make those cities that are going to be sanctuaries for immigrants that don't want to make them the bad guys. Or maybe go to more traditional scapegoats. You do know who I mean, don't you? Black people. Come on, you know. The people who've been treated this way repeatedly in American history when things got tough. That'll be the temptation. I'm not saying it's gonna happen, but the temptation. The man is working himself into a corner politically and economically. He has no way to do what he promised. And what is he gonna do when that becomes clear? That, as far as I can tell, that's the $64 billion question about this government as it is working its way to a dead end that is scary to contemplate. Thank you very much, all of you, for your time.